بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Dear listeners, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. A very good evening and welcome back to Friday Night Fusion, the new sound of Great Britain, live and interactive on 93.5 Unity FM across Birmingham and surrounding areas, both nationally and internationally on www.unityfm.net. Now, the representation of the Muslim community has been the subject of great debate over the past few years. How do we promote Islam? How do we talk to non-Muslims about what we as a community stand for? Our young people are always in need for positive role models, somebody they can look up to, somebody they can aspire to be like. But where do they look for those fantastic role models? And how do we, most importantly, get our young people back onto the Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path, the path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for each and every one of us. Now, mashallah, my special guest this evening is somebody who is internationally acclaimed for doing exactly that. Through the art of spoken word, he has won many, many awards on an international level, has traveled around the world speaking about Islam and really getting people to look at issues from a very different and unique and positive perspective. Brother Buna Muhammad joins me on the line now. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Buna Muhammad. Jazakallah khair for joining us today, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Very honored to be here.
First and foremost, the art of spoken word is very interesting, and it's a phenomena that really holds a lot of appeal, especially for our younger generation. But let's start at the very beginning. As a child, did you always know in your heart of hearts that spoken word was the career or was the interest that you would want to pursue in the future?
Actually, when I was younger, I was interested in, you know, writing short stories. As a child, you know, a lot of our learning is actually done through rhyme and rhythm. They teach you, you know, these little, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da. You learn about these different stories and characters, and it always takes place through rhyme. It always takes place through this, you know, interactive form of storytelling. So I think, like any young person, I did, you know, have a passion for listening to it. I was drawn towards that style and genre of storytelling at a young age. And when I got a bit older, I decided to kind of put the the pen to the pad, and I started writing some short stories. They weren't necessarily in rhyme or prose or rhythm or anything of that sort. It was just creative outbursts of, you know, funny little situations that I had occurred in my own life, I guess.
And these stories that you began to write, they weren't overtly, I suppose, just connected to Islam or an Islamic message. You also put across many general messages, many moral and ethical messages for young people as well, didn't you?
Yeah. I mean, actually, what I'm referring to, the stories, this was like elementary school, so this is probably when I was about, you know, 10 or 11 years old. I mean, at that time, to be honest, I didn't have that much of an Islamic upbringing. Alhamdulillah, I do come from Muslim families, but my family at that point wasn't too engulfed in Islamic knowledge. A lot of us were kind of, you know, cultural Muslims, I guess you could say. So the understanding that I had of the world was a very secular one. But my parents did, you know, come to Canada as political refugees. So I did understand a little bit about politics. I did understand a little bit about human rights, about, you know, discrimination, about racism, about these types of issues, which I felt, you know, appealed to me, I guess, on a day-to-day basis. And mind you, this was, you know, I feel kind of silly to say, but, you know, before 9/11, a lot of Muslims themselves didn't really know about Islam. You know, before September 11th, a lot of Muslims themselves were kind of just, you know, Muslims on the outset. Like, you just had, your last name is Muhammad. You just kind of, you know, maybe went to Eid Salah, and then that was it. Islam was a very, it didn't really shape your life. It was just kind of a thing that was passed down to you.
Yes.
It wasn't until, especially living in North America, it wasn't until after 9/11 when a lot of Muslims began to, you know, almost awaken and figure out, like, because, you know, what does my last name really mean? Like, who am I? Why do people start, you know, why do people hate me all of a sudden? And so that really became almost a catalyst to learn more about the deen.
And you grew up, you obviously knew from a very young age that writing, using literature, using that form of channeling your emotions and also your feelings, your views, was an interest that you certainly had. How did that begin to flourish? You mentioned the fact that your parents, your family were political refugees. I presume that when you were actually growing up, times must have been quite hard for you. So how did you get the adequate nurturing and the adequate support to go on to become such a successful figure in the field of writing and spoken word?
Yeah, actually, my parents were writers as well. My father's a pretty well-known poet in our community. He's written short stories, and he's had a book of his own poetry published in our native tongue, which is it's Oromo language, which is a dialect spoken in Ethiopia. So, you know, from that outset, like, it's funny because I know in some Muslim families, particularly in some communities, arts is sometimes looked down upon, and, you know, parents would rather force their kids into sciences and maths and engineering and doctors. And I guess in a weird way, my family was, already involved in art. They had a found respect for it. And at that time, there was a cultural renaissance happening in Ethiopia that was being used to, you know, promote our political struggle. So there was this sense that art can help change. It was a very secular sense, but if you look at many, you know, quote-unquote revolutions or movements around the world, art has always kind of taken a place and a role in it. So I think they were coming from that background. So they had this love and interest of art in a political sense. And so I saw it around me. You know, I saw it around me in the paintings that were, you know, put in my house, the different types of, literacy and books and poetry and stories that my parents would read to me and understand themselves. So I knew at a bit of an older age that my father was actually a writer as well. And so there was always that, you know, it wasn't looked down upon. It wasn't shunned. When I was in school, for me to, you know, be a part of a writing competition and show it to my parents, it wasn't a bad thing. It was like, you know, it was cool. It was fine. I always had that support. And I guess it was pretty much whatever direction I decided to take, my parents would have, you know, they would have supported me or shunned me. But alhamdulillah, this decision to get into arts wasn't anything that they looked down upon at all.
MashaAllah, and you're very lucky there that you had a parent who was already involved in the field of writing, the field of poetry, and your parents in general and your wider family were more than willing to support you in whatever you decided to do. Did it ever occur to you though, Brother Buna Muhammad, that perhaps if you did pursue the arts, if you did pursue this mission of yours to be a poet, be a writer, be a spoken word artist, that perhaps it may not be financially fruitful for you? I know from speaking to a number of parents across the country and across the world who fit into this stereotype of Muslim parents that they often want their children to become doctors, lawyers and professors because they know that not only will the job be rewarding, but also will secure them financially. Did that worry ever occur to you?
Ironically enough, I think a lot of people don't realize that, for people that love this, you don't do it for the money. You know, I never started off with the intention of making money. I never started off with the thought even that you could make money. It really was a form of like self-therapy. You know, I was just speaking, relating to young people, getting my thoughts and words out there, trying to connect the dots between, you know, my identity, who I was as a Muslim, as an African, as a Canadian. These were interesting themes and ideas that I wanted to share and spread with people. I had a background in, in communications and media. I also, I have a degree, a four-year degree that I got in media broadcasting. So that wasn't necessarily, you know, poetry wasn't my career choice. You know, sure. A lot of times people, I mean, I'm sure parents can understand this themselves. A lot of times the thing that you study in school isn't even really the thing that you do in full-time life, you know. We kind of look for our money in places other than our passion. And that's really unfortunate because a lot of people end up going to work every day and hating their lives. You know, you end up doing your 9-to-5 and really just dreading the moment, you know, you have to walk in the door.
Whereby
the richest person is the person who actually has a passion, a job that they do, that they love. They get to go to work each day and they do it with ihsan. They do it with, you know, this complete certainty that, you know, they're working their best to fulfill that agreement or obligation they have between themselves and their employer or whatever. My theory in life, even from a young age, it's always been never work at something you don't want to do. You know, I never, even when I was younger, I never took jobs, you know, the occasional odd job here and there, but I always did things that I liked. You know, I was always involved in different jobs that I found to be beneficial for me, not just as a, you know, a Muslim, but as a human being.
Yes.
And so I think sometimes parents need to just, you know, chill out. Like, you need to realize that, you know, this was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Absolutely.
There's something that you could do. You could have your PhD in whatever, and you could still be broke. You know, you can have all the money in the world, and it won't even dent your soul. Mm. Like, you might not benefit from it in that sense at all. You might have all this money, but still, you know, your life is being pulled. You're working 23 hours a day, and you don't get to see your family. That's not a life to live. You know.
Yes, definitely. And I think a lot of people will find your words very useful there because obviously we are currently living in a time of great economic austerity. Things are very bad economically, and government, schools, and various other parts of our society are encouraging young people in particular to go out there and do something for nothing, get involved in voluntary work and pursue your passion. I know something that you posted on Twitter just in the past day or so was something to the effect of some people out there are very poor, the only thing they have is money, and I think that's very important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that, you know, especially I guess where I come from, where, you know, a lot of us as immigrants, as refugees come from, you see, man, people live back home with very little. They're happy. You know, a lot of times they don't need, you know, the $1,000,000 or pounds that we strive for. But as long as they, you know, alhamdulillah, they have their deen, they have their family, you know, they have these things, and they can find a sense of happiness. And the Prophet ﷺ, he prophesied in our ummah, he said, you know, the problem in our ummah wouldn't be, you know, poverty. He feared for us wealth. You know, he feared for us that we would have too much money. Now look at, you know, you have people in the Middle East, subhanAllah, you know, some of these countries like Dubai and the UAE where these guys are, you know, the oil is just getting to their heads, right? And they have way too much money. And then you have some places in Africa, subhanAllah, look at West Africa, East Africa, some people who they have no money, you know? And I don't think these two factors determine happiness at all, because you can find people on both ends who are happy and not happy. So I think as Muslims, we should be striving to, especially for our children, you know, put them in careers and fields where they're going to not just, you know, benefit themselves, but benefit the ummah. I think at this point, we really need to do a, you know, kind of like a resource check and figure, okay, what do we need? You know, we have way too many engineers. We have way too many doctors. We have way too many people in the science and, you know, math field. But what we don't have is, look at around now, I mean, media, we're slacking. We don't have good, proper PR representation.
Yes.
You know, we don't have people who are trained in specialty fields. Sure. We don't have people who can, you know, deal with Muslim political affairs in a sense where, like, you know, Muslims are being put into courts. Muslims are being, I don't know if we need lawyers, barristers, whatever we need. You know, we need people to start doing a resource check as to what can they do for the ummah. You know, when I got into my field, my 4-year degree, it was I have a media background. This was something that there was, I think, it's a very elite program. They only accept 160 students each year, and there was one other Muslim girl. That's it.
Yes.
The rest of it were, you know, certain faiths which control media, and other groups who, you know, obviously recognize the need to have, you know, media representation. But as a Muslim, there was just me and another girl, and at that time, none of us were really practicing, anyways. But it really just showed you, you know, where our priorities are. You know, our priorities are, unfortunately, you know, not necessarily because medicine's a bad thing. I'm sure, you know, there's a lot of khair that can come from helping and serving people. But let's be realistic. People only become doctors for money. Very few people have a drive, in my opinion, to, you know, change the world through medicine, right? You want to change the world through your pockets. That's why you got into the field to begin with, or your family kind of forced you into it, right? And that's cool. Alhamdulillah, use that money, do something good with it. But in terms of an everyday benefit, I feel like there's a lot more we could be providing, not just for ourselves, but for the entire community as well.
Sure, I think a lot of doctors out there would have a variety of opinions on why they got involved in medicine, but we do take your point, the fact that we do need Muslims in all sorts of areas, all sorts of walks of life, rather than just going into one or two professions and the others are subsequently neglected at our own detriment. Now, you mentioned a very interesting point there regarding how we need to get into different professions and we need to expand our horizon and also take a lead from our young people in terms of what they would like to do in the future. How do we get the traditional mindset out of members of our community or certain parents out there who are still quite intent on their children becoming lawyers, professors, doctors, because the background they come from sometimes is one of poverty and is one where they did find it difficult to find ends, to get ends to meet. And the concern that many people may argue these sorts of parents and members of the community have is that their children may not be able to provide for themselves if they become a painter or an artist.
Again, you know, I think that we have to remember that the rizq is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't mean that you know, put your hands behind your back and sit in the, you know, the masjid and beg. But it also doesn't mean that you know, sell your soul to whatever corporation or business, you know, you feel can best satisfy your financial needs. I think there's a balance. You know, I think there's a way in the middle. And I think that it really does involve us looking at fields and careers which, you know, alhamdulillah, can benefit, but also, I'll give you an example, okay? So, like, my background has always been, you know, arts, entertainment, that type of field.
Sure.
It was inclined towards media and media broadcasting. And media is a very large field, right? Within media, you have camera operators, you have, you know, you have TV producers, you have writers, you have, you know, lighting technicians. You have, like, a whole field that you can kind of play around in, right?
Sure.
So, like, I don't think sometimes when parents when people look at, you know, careers, it's very black and white, right? It's like, okay, what type of doctor do you want to be? You know, it's like there's really, you know what I'm saying, no looking outside of that world. And again, like, I don't know, personally for myself, I found it hard. I have a very short attention span. I found it hard going into a job, sitting in a cubicle, you know, responding to, you know, my office emails, like that type of thing. I couldn't do, like, I felt like I would be faking it, you know. There's other people who I'm sure are great at it, and it doesn't bother them, and they don't mind. But I feel like in order to change that mindset, I mean, Allahu A'lam, I really don't know, you know, what we can do to influence a community that has been so, you know, deprived of that understanding, right? I think a lot of it has to do with slowly people kind of maybe taking those steps and, you know, setting a positive example so that people can look back and be like, oh, well, you know, such and such person went in this field and, you know, alhamdulillah, they're doing okay. You know, just like when you have that older brother, that older sister, you know, they go off and do something, it kind of makes the way easier for you, you know, like you can explain that to your parents as an example.
Hmm.
So I think that the people who do go off into it, we got to be the best. You know, if you do decide to go on to those fields as an artist, you know, you can't be, and I guess, you know, part of it, there's a different context to art, by the way, in North America and the UK, because I think the UK has a very, you know, long history, British people specifically, of like arts, of, you know, theater, of that type. And you have like full-time artists, you know. Even where I'm coming from, I wouldn't consider myself a full-time artist. You know, there's a difference.
Right.
I'm an artist who does art on the side, but I don't necessarily look for it to my as my full source of income. Like, I can have a job and do what I do. You know, it's not impossible. I can be, you know, relatively involved in the arts community, as people think I am now. People think I'm, mashallah, you know, like all I do is eat, breathe, and sleep poetry, right? That's what they think. But the reality is that, no, I was a full-time teacher in an Islamic school last year. I took the year off now. But I, you know, I have a full-time career that I can also pursue. So, again, if you're doing art for the right reasons, which shouldn't be money, you will find a way to let the art out anyways.
Sure.
You know, I don't think that children should even look at art. Like, you could be a doctor and be an artist. Mm. It's not a problem. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Art shouldn't be something you do for money.
So
if you're doing it for money, yeah.
What you're saying really, Brother Buddha Muhammad, is that it's all about diversity and keeping your options open and keeping yourself busy ultimately.
Yeah, I think, and you know, art does provide a healthy, you know, alternative to a lot of the things kids waste their time with, you know, especially if they're involved in a healthy practice and art form. You can find, you know, good people and good thoughts that occur, you know, in artistic circles. And I think that, like I was saying before, you know, you can still have a life. You can still have a career that may not be artistically focused and be engaged in the arts, whether you're, you know, a lover of the arts or you're actually an implementation of the arts. You're actually writing and you're creating and you're sharing, you know. These things can still be done. And I think at a young age, we have to not shun our kids, you know, when they're in school and they, you know, go to whatever, they can choose whichever programs they want to enter, even in an elementary level. If they choose the arts, you know, we should say, alhamdulillah, this is good. Let them expand themselves.
Absolutely.
This will only help them in other aspects of their life as well. The more well-rounded you are, the more benefit you can offer in other fields as well, too, inshallah.
Inshallah, inshallah. Now, mashallah, you were lucky enough, talking about support, to receive that support, to move forward and become immensely successful. You've had millions of hits on your videos on YouTube that we see on a regular basis, mashallah. Did you ever anticipate this level of success when you initially started off doing this professionally and you initially started off putting your full heart into it and gained the understanding of what you could actually do through art, through poetry, and through writing?
Yeah, well, I mean, I have to almost backtrack to a certain extent because I think a lot of people are seeing me now, like in the last, you know, 2-3 years, maybe in the last year, people are noticing me now, in the Muslim community specifically, you know, they're looking at, they're saying, wow, mashallah, but they don't know, I have a long history, right, because I've been writing professionally, performing professionally for about 6 or 7 years. So when I was quite young, actually, I'm 25 years old now. So when I was about 18, 19, I got my first shot at a poetry competition. We have these things called slam poetry competitions. Okay, so they're like figure skating for poetry. You go up, you do your poem, you know, you get judged. And that's the, when you were mentioning earlier about the competitions I won, they came from this era. So while I was doing slam poetry, you know, a lot of my content, like I was mentioning, wasn't necessarily Islamically based. A lot of it was political. A lot of it was socially aimed at shifting and changing the climate which I was living in, which was a post-9/11 North America anyway. So in that sense, essence of it were Islamic, but it wasn't full-on maybe Islam like people would be used to me saying stuff like today, right?
Hmm.
So that work itself, you know, I was doing it with the hopes that I would change people's mindsets, with the hopes that people would, you know, shift their line of thinking, but on a you know, a smaller scale, I wasn't necessarily looking at the world. I was looking at the city and the country I was coming from. I had no major aspirations of going overseas or anything of that sort.
Right.
And it's ironic because even at that point, like, I'll be honest, you know, and I don't approve of it today, but I was involved in music as well. I was involved in that form of creativity where I was, you know, being backed up with, you know, some instruments and stuff like that. So then I was pretty big. Like, I mean, in the city of Toronto where I come from, I had a pretty, you know, good following. I had a, you know, a good manager. I was doing both. So I was doing spoken word poetry and I was doing music at the same time. And I had a pretty good influence in both fields.
I see.
And it wasn't until I kind of had almost like a mental breakdown where I just said, like, you know, I didn't feel like the benefit I was having. Because here, I mean, to these people, I was just generically black, right? I just followed this black stereotype of, you know, a lot of Caribbean youth that you find in the UK, especially, where they just kind of box everybody into one box.
Definitely,
and whatever
yes.
problems affect one, affect the other. So
right.
I realized that, look, this community that I was, you know, a part of, which was the kind of African-centered black community in Canada, I just felt like it wasn't fair representation of myself and that I had a larger and deeper identity, which was Islam. And I didn't really know much about it, but I wanted to explore it. So I ended up going overseas. I just kind of ran away from my band members for, you know, a couple months. And I went to Egypt. I learned to, you know, I mean, I was learning Arabic. I was studying the Quran. I was, you know, trying to deeper my own spiritual understanding of myself. And then when I came back, I realized that I could still, you know, this is from the we look at the traditions of the companions around the Prophet, like even companions like Hassan ibn Thabit, you know, who was the poet of the Prophet, who had a skill that he used in Jahiliyyah, that when the time came in Islam, he could use it for the same cause and benefit, right?
Alhamdulillah.
So I said, you know what, let me try and use similar examples. So I continued writing poetry when I came back. The first poem I released when I got back was For the Love. And it's a poem that, like, to this day, I think it has the most views, almost a 500,000 amount of views. And it's about, you know, me writing about my love, which was Islam. And I didn't know at that point how to express it to people, because there was a lot of non-Muslims that I was around. And trying to explain to them, you know, why you don't want to go to a club, why you want to sit home and pray, you know, go to the mosque, for them, it doesn't connect.
It's
a lot
quite
of
difficult.
Times people,
yes.
It's quite difficult. And I felt myself always at a loss for words, trying to explain to them why this was the right way. So I wrote it as a love poem. I wrote it as anyone understands love. You know, these people always understand why these crazy lovers do what they do, right? So, I mean, we are lovers of our deen,
alhamdulillah.
So I was trying to explain to them, you know, where I was coming from. And I think that was kind of my introduction to using Islam as a, you know, as my focal point for my writing. And, you know, subhanAllah, at that point, I really realized that, you know, there was no money in it. There was no real Islamic poetry scene at that scene. I was literally doing it for nothing. And whereas before, when I was doing the music and stuff like that, there was a chance and hopes that you might make money or whatever, right? But the moment I switched my focus to Islam is the moment I started actually getting big, is the moment I started getting more notice. I started traveling. I started being invited to all these different events. And wallahi subhanAllah, when you leave something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives you something better. This
mashallah.
Is true in my own life. I can see this in my own life.
How beautiful that is, mashallah, because obviously your love for Islam, although it was temporarily not giving you as much financial benefit as perhaps you'd received when you were involved in producing mainstream content, you had such a great passion within you to continue doing what you were doing for the sake of the deen, that you continued, mashallah, and you persevered. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has rewarded you with such a huge element of success, millions of views, millions of fans all across the world. And unfortunately, time is our only enemy, and we really do appreciate you giving up your valuable time for us this evening. But in a great time of difficulty, both for the Muslims and generally for people out there, with economically we seeing a very bad spiral only going downwards, especially here in the UK and Europe, and I suppose some parts of the world as a whole, and then the other crisis that the Muslims have, which is a crisis of deen, specifically our young people, what would be your main brief piece of advice to them? And please do feel free to put it in poetry if you wish, inshallah.
I will give you the statement which Allah Azza wa Jal first told His Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which was Iqra. You know, we need to be a people who are increasing ourselves in knowledge. You know, Iqra, read, recite, learn, understand, engage yourselves in positive aspects of learning. You know, I think that the main problem of our ummah is ignorance of our deen. This is a number one concern. If we had deen, everything would make sense. We would know how to deal with poverty. We would know how to deal with wealth. You know, people paid their zakat, we would fix the world's economy. If people all got up and prayed Fajr at the same time, you know, every day in the masjid, you would have a community of unity. You'd have people who loved each other. If we spread the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, there's no way non-Muslims could hate us. They would see the beauty in us, and they would love and join our deen. It all comes back to Islam. You know, the reason why we are in the position we're in today is because we're not actually, we're Muslims, but we're not following Islam. There's a difference. Mm-hmm. You know, we are the Muslims, but you can't really see Islam in us 100% of the time. The things that we do oftentimes are very cultural. You know, you do things because this is the way they do it in Pakistan. You do things because this is the way they do it in Somalia. You do things because in the Arab Peninsula, this is what you were taught. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
We are not following Islam. We're following our own cultural desires. And it's not until we return back to Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will restore his izzah, his honor for us, inshallah.
Inshallah, inshallah. Brother Buna Muhammad, it's been an absolute honor having you on the radio station this evening, and we thank you again for your time and for your inspirational words of wisdom that you have beautifully and eloquently portrayed and put forward to the Muslims of Birmingham, the United Kingdom and the world, inshallah, here on Unity FM tonight. Jazakallah khair, brother.
Jazakallah khair. And I really love to thank Birmingham. They always give me a, you know, a really good response in the UK in total. So I just want to, you know, jazakallah khair for all the support I've received, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, unite us all in general,
Ameen.
Inshallah.
Ameen.